Celada. What are the main factors impacting accounting firms in this particular COVID environment?
I would answer that in two ways, the ability and inability to service their clients. So when I say ability, the loan, right, the loan situation, influx of a lot of new work that not everyone wanted to pay for or expected to be given for free, so sucking up the bandwidth. The inability, or maybe not inability, but lack of willingness to step into that role and actually have a bigger conversation. It's not about the loan, it's about survival, and it's not just about survival, it's about how do we thrive. So continuing that conversation with a business owner about continuing business and growing business in these times.
Are there a number of accounting firms who, that won't make it?
I think that's the fear, absolutely. I think that's the fear. And I think it's not that they just won't make it, they won't ever achieve that dream practice. They'll go back or revert back to the 90-hour work week, finding and scrapping for the low price fee client, competing against all the individual returns and going back to the stuff they know exists that they can go get, but not looking at the abundance of how do we help businesses grow, not looking at the service level of abundance. You know, clients still need more. I think you said it with 75% of businesses or small restaurants may fail. They need help. These are opportunities, right? Not to just make money, but to change people's lives.
Do you think the firms that are operating at the margins are putting downward pressure on firms that really want to grow and prosper?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, right? I think the accounting profession has done a great job, and I mean this with love and respect, of putting the pressure, the downward pressure on traditionally, right, since its existence. It's a competition on fee. It's being the low-cost leaders versus actually stepping out and being a firm that can actually make impact. So yeah, absolutely. I think what's going to happen is you have a lot of firms out there that are going to only compete on fee because I think that's all that's available to them. That's the only differentiator.
What are the characteristics for predicting success these days?
Yeah, believe it or not, even in this experience now, it's the firms that are looking to charge a premium price, backing it up by doing advisory services, not just the compliance work, looking to make an impact on their clients. And what we're finding is that the clients that focus on the business owners, small to medium enterprises across the board, are the ones that are actually flourishing right now. So getting out of the idea or dependency on individual tax or compliance work, getting into focusing on the business owners who are out there wanting, needing, praying for this kind of help, for someone to come and guide them through not just COVID, but growth, profitability, getting to that next escalon. That's where we're seeing a lot of people make it firm-wise. And to do that, you need to be well-leveraged. You know, an advisor for many small sole practice to small partner firms, it's the partners, owners that are actually doing the advisory. So you need to be able to leverage. So we're finding the ones that are using a tech deck, leveraged through technology, right? We can't keep going back to Excel. We can't keep going back to the old way of doing things, but it's really excelling at leveraging the technology, developing their team members, making great hires and developing their team members towards advisory. So not building for capacity on the compliance end, but building towards advisory, allowing them to be much more agile in the ever-changing environment that we're in.
It's possible even in this difficult, crazy time for accounting firms to grow and prosper.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There are a ton of people, businesses and people that need help. And those accounting firms that are willing to step into that role, not play shy, but go out there and be that advisor are flourishing right now.
What are the key ingredients CPA firms need to be that advisor?
Well, the beauty is they have the number one ingredient. They have the goods. They've been doing this work for a long time. Many of them have experienced multiple businesses, tons of businesses. So they have the experience, the know-how. They can read the financial tea leaves. Now it's just the willingness, the mindset to play a bigger role, the desire to play a bigger role, not play small, but play big in their particular market, in their community.
How does a CPA firm start to think about shifting their mindset?
I think the accounting owner, partner, the mindset shift is being more utilized, shifting to being of service. We're already as accountants, here's the funny thing. As accountants, we will serve everybody with all that we have, .. to the detriment of ourselves, right? So we already have the ability now serve people in the right way. So the shift is how do we serve not to save money, but to make money? How do we serve not to maintain, but to grow? So it's shifting that historical review that we're all accustomed to and moving to windshield, what's up ahead, what's the bigger growth, what's the play? So the shift is not just keeping the status quo, but helping people move towards where they want to go in a forward-looking direction.
How does the accountant start that conversation?
I think you just said the first part one, start the conversation. And the conversation starts with questions. What are your challenges? Where do you want to go? What does this business look like at a successful level? What's preventing us from getting there? I think, Rick, what we've always seen in the past is the accounting profession loves to go out there and talk about our experience, talk about how good we are, we'll return calls in 24 hours, and we'll talk about the existing numbers. But we haven't really did a great job of stepping back and asking the client, where are you headed? Where are you going? What's most preventing you from getting there? What do you really want? Not just out of the business, but out of life. And that, I think, is the start of the conversation that we've seen a lot of success with, because we move it from the impersonal to the personal.
How does that conversation go?
Starts with the end in mind. End in mind. Where are we headed? What does this need to look like? And again, I think that conversation really alludes to aligning the business objectives with the personal goals of the owner. So if we're able to mesh those, and many people don't do that, and that's where I think the biggest misstep in advisory has actually happened. We haven't aligned the business objectives with the personal goals. We've only focused on the business objectives in most cases. And if not the business objectives, the current financials. So it's that meshing and that conversation of what does that need to look like? Because the numbers and the objectives for most small to medium enterprises, the business is a vehicle to their fulfillment and success.
What kind of personal goals are relevant to an accountant working on a business?
Sure. I think the personal goals are, what do you want to do with this business? We are missing opportunities on the exit plan, the transition plan, but even before that, what should this business be providing you as the owner? What lifestyle should be providing you? And this goes beyond just money, because as we know, even in our own profession, it's not just the financial gains, it's the freedom we get back. It's the hours back in our day. And on top of that, when we get to the personal, we're all human. Most of these people that started their business, they're looking for a legacy. They're looking to provide for their families in a new way or a different way where they haven't been able to do before.
How many accountants do you think are actually qualified or interested in making this mindset shift?
I think it's definitely the majority. In our experience, what we're encountering is people, I want a different life. I want a different firm. They want to give up the 90-hour work week. We want to, you know, work less, earn more, and play a bigger role. Everyone's looking for fulfillment for the most, right? I would say easily in the 80 to 90%, the accountants that I've worked with or talked to, they want a more fulfilling, not just practice, but client, the work that they provide. They want to play a bigger role than just being the tax grunt or the bean counter.
But what concrete steps do they have to do to actually start moving in that direction?
Well, I love how you frame that. Commitment. I'm big on commitment. We have to commit to a value price fee, a premium fee for the work that we're doing. If we don't commit to that, then we just end up being the low-cost leaders we've always been, right? So the first thing is commitment to a minimum fee on the premium price level, a commitment to providing advisory. It's not just an item on the menu of our websites. We all seen that. Most of the accounting firms out there have an advisory tab, right? It's going beyond that. It's every conversation with your business clients, at least, is about the holistic view of what needs to happen in the business, why it needs to happen, and what it means to them personally. That's the conversation. I think the other part is a commitment to allowing the low-cost leaders to be low-cost leaders and take that low-level fee engagement that you have, the once-a-year tax return, the project work, the clients that want to fight and nag on fee, give them to the low-cost leaders and commit to yourself that you are now a premium-based practice, focused on advisory and playing a different role with your business clients.
How do you become a premium price practice?
Beautiful. For the good news for most people out there, they have an established practice. So they have a book of business. Great. The beauty in it all is pruning. When you prune a nice garden, what happens? It produces more. It becomes more vibrant. It becomes more abundant. No different from the accounting practice. So you have a book of business. We make commitments. Commitment number one, all new work or a focus of new work engagements coming in is moving to the advisory level, premium price, ongoing monthly engagements, right? That's going to provide a few things. Confidence is going to provide you a new layer of client and a breath of fresh air coming into your book of business. So you're going to get some early yardage and proof of concept just by shifting over to that. The next part, yes, and you said it, we're going to start to remove or transition out those clients that are no longer a fit. And let's be honest, Rick, a lot of our clients that we look at, I've seen, and this is pretty much on average, 26 to 30% of someone's book of business is only making up to 9% of their revenue. And for some of those people, you're into the hundreds. You're into the hundreds. And what is that? That's a suck on bandwidth. And it's a drain on culture, and it's an anchor holding these firms back. So if we can start to transition those people out, replacing them again with the new engagements coming in, and then as we prune, yes, because you are a premium-based practice, and you should view that already, right? You know, the funny thing about this, Rick, is I talked to a lot of accounting firms that say, we're the best in the area. We have the highest integrity. People love us, but we hope our prices land in the middle. We have to have a price, right, that reflects the value that we provide, not just to the community, but to the services that we're, and the impacts we're making out there with the clients. So we have go out there, commit to getting new engagements at a premium price level, focused on advisory. We got the transition, those bad fits out. They're not bad people, just bad fits for where this business is going, right? And then we start to raise our fees to be more comparable to or reflective of the kind of practice that we are.
How much time does it take for a firm to fully transition to a premium price practice once they've committed to do so?
And it's going to sound odd, but the reality is it's not overnight, but it can be done in a week. And what I mean by that is we get three premium price engagements, $2,000, $3,000, $5,000 a month, and they're out there. The reality shifts for the owner. So not that you have to have this big practice, but the three shifts that financial reality, and all of a sudden time becomes available. All of a sudden the value we perceive in ourselves goes higher. So with those three, what we're seeing is three, and then that three becomes six, and that six becomes 12. You're almost at the point where you're making more money than you were with all those other clients as you transition ones out. And you're seeing you can get there pretty quick. So it can happen. We've seen it happen in less than a year. We've seen people double income. We've seen people keep the same revenue, but free up half the time that was being spent previously. So can it happen? It can happen very quickly.
So what's a typical bundle? What's a typical service package?
So here's a not so great answer, but the deal is this. It can be as big or as small as you like, as long as it has this framework. So take it, not everyone does the compliance. Some of the clients we work with, accountants, are playing the advisor role without doing the compliance or tax work. But they've committed to the value that they provide as what some would call an outsourced CFO, as others would call a profitability and growth advisor or a value business advisor. But the basic is this, you need to include, we have to get clarity. We have to have a plan. So we talked about questions. We need to take those questions and use those questions to get more clear with the business owners. Where are we headed? What does success look like? Then from there, and I like using a three-year format. So where we need to be in 3 years. But then more importantly, we get down to what does the next 12 months look like working together? Milestones and objectives. So as you see, it's kind of like clearing out, right? It's clearing the mud from the water. Let's get clear about really where you're headed. Now that we have that, let's get clear what needs to be accomplished just over the next 12 months. And then more specifically into a quarterly action plan. What are the actions we're most focused on and will be priority? And within that, now you're going to be able to pull in from your financial planning, your financial monitoring, cash flow analysis, prediction, budget, forecast, etc. It all starts to make sense in the business owner's mind. That's what makes this simple but hugely valuable to the owner, because this is the time where the owner actually understands what you do for me as an advisor and what the impact and results of that may be.
Is this a particularly good or bad environment to make that kind of transformation?
Well, but we're finding it's actually an awesome environment to make that transformation. What we're seeing is this conversation, although it's always been needed, now more than ever, the conversation has shifted to, do you want to keep your business? If we keep your business, what's that business need to look like? Not just for survival, but to thrive. So now people more than ever have been focused on their businesses. Now when we've been able to be somewhat successful but lazy, we have to be more mindful and present with where this business is headed and how the environment is ever changing even more quickly. For those who've been on the edge, who've kind of just been stagnant, they've been focused on the business. I want to keep it now, right? The emphasis now is help me keep my business. I want to hear from you. I want to talk about it more. They're looking for a way to not just survive, but thrive. We don't even have to talk about how the loans have been a great entry point to that conversation. Do I need a loan? How do I keep compliant on that loan? And what am I going to do with that loan to make good on it, not just to pay it back, but make good on this business and this investment, really.
From where you sit, what's the future environment look like for accountants?
The future environment has already set its tone to, we need to be playing a bigger role, a different role. There are too many players coming in. And I think with what we were just referring to, the experience is, it's not just going to be the accountant in the space anymore. It's the software company. It's the non-accounting professionals that are able to come in and provide some of these services. To your point, if it does end up as a 24-hour work, we're going to be stuck where we need more of a workforce, and people are going to find a lot of opportunity in that need. And it's not going to be accountants. So what I think the forecast really is you're going to see more accountants because the need is now, or the demand is now, landing on their doorstep more and more. And it's not just the client. Even the banks are leaning on the accountants, is what I'm seeing, to say, help these people understand the loans. The bank doesn't want to talk about the loan with a client. They don't want to talk about how you go and fill out the application. They want the accountant to have that. And they're actually pushing those businesses to their accountants. Now, the accountants, what conversation are you going to have with them? I think the demand now is, what do I do with this loan? How do I keep compliant? How do I get forgiveness? That's been a hot topic and trend, obviously. They need to talk about oversight. They need to know how to charge for that. They need to know how to have that conversation and turn it into not just this moment in time, but a holistic conversation about the business and what the business owner wants from the business. So I see a lot of competition coming down the road. I see the accountant needing to shift into playing a different role, a bigger role with their clients. Absolutely.
What kind of competition do you see coming into this market?
I think you're going to see some software companies coming in to play a role in the compliance side, tax, right, with the ease of regulations. You're seeing that the environment is primed for software and technology integration. We've been headed that way, and I think we've just been pushed 5 years ahead, quite honestly, given what's going on. So I think you're going to have those players coming in. I think also the ability to bring in people that are non-accounting professionals are going to come in and make a play for some of that business. Again, usually what we see, unfortunately, is the outside of the profession is a much more leveraged, technology-driven business or solution for many of these people to work with. And on top of that, you're going to have individuals that are going to feel that they can actually do this themselves more and more, right? Technology, knowledge that's available to them now. Ease of regulations, again, provides a space where more individuals, we have free tax software out there now. We have more and more people getting that training for free as well. Some of them from their accountants even, right? So I think that the hot take is we're losing ground in market share in the bottom level space of compliance and tax. And I think you're going to see some accountants, unfortunately, transition out early, sell or be acquired. And I think you're going to see a number of accountants step into the role of advisor. And the shift in the profession will be toward true advisory, working with your clients at a much different rate, not just bundled services, not the micro value priced bundled engagements, but advisors from the accounting space stepping in and playing a bigger role ongoing with their clients.
What kind of tools and resources can accountants look for in the marketplace in order to help them through this transformation from compliance to advisory?
Tools are tools, and tools are great. I love tools. It's an ability to have and build relationships with your existing clients. And that requires a particular skill set, not to go out there and hawk product, but to connect and understand your client and serve your client through conversation. The ability to ask questions, do deep discovery, and understand what the real needs are. And again, how we align those business objectives to support those personal goals and needs of the owner. So first and foremost, what I see out there is a great communication program, sales program, that helps accountants quickly understand and take their existing skill set and move it into servicing their clients in a much better way.
Mike Celada, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick.
What's wrong with the conventional wisdom about pricing advisory services these days?
I think in a phrase, it's built around playing not to lose versus playing to win. What I mean by that is we're still worried about competition. We're willing to value price as long as it's not too high and as long as it's a little bit incremental shift. And we'll bundle more services to do that, except we're sucking up more of our bandwidth, right? We're sucking up more of our capacity. So the conventional wisdom, at one point, great, no longer, I think, works in today's accounting business moving to advisory. If we're going to do it, we already provide the value. We need to reflect that value in what we charge. And not just for the hours worked, but for the impact on results, for the value of our lifetime of experience and our experiences with multiple businesses that we're bringing to the table.
Are you suggesting that conventional wisdom on advisory services these days is including the wrong set of services or just not pricing them properly?
Both. I think it's not necessarily the wrong set of services, it's still the wrong focus. We're still focused heavily on compliance and tax and traditional services with this cherry on top of advisory. So we're giving away all of the gold for the low cost, high competitive services that already exist. So that's that. And then, yes, coming to a service level, we have to make an impact on our clients. We have to make an impact on results, and we have to create the space and time to do so. So that service level, you know, meeting with a client regularly, talking about not just historic numbers, but what it means to the forecast, what it means toward the personal goals. That's a shift, for sure.
Does that mean doing less compliance work or pricing the compliance work as integral to the advisory package?
The answer is both. I think nowadays, for those of we have accountants that don't want to do the work. So they're showing up, still doing the work, not doing the best job because we're not our best selves doing it. But there's leverage available, right? We have outsourcing. We have not just overseas, but even in the community. We have a number of accounts that will leverage other bookkeepers, other accountants that want to focus on that work. We have technologies that will help focus on that work. So I think it's what it is. It's a more of a focus on the advisory. And then how do we support the compliance or traditional services? Now, more than ever, we have a wealth of resources available to support that.
So explain to me how that's bundled or priced differently than most accounting firms might be doing it now.
Well, let's be honest. Most accounting firms that are doing it now are including the advisory with the traditional services. So they're giving it away. They're not even getting, if anything, there's a small incremental increase to the service, but it's not on a proactive or structured level by any means. You know, we're talking about moving to a monthly or frequent interaction with your client. We're talking about building a plan with your client to work towards. This can't be the bottom-up approach that we've done conventionally. The bottom-up approach being, let's start with the numbers, let's start with the basic necessities, and then one day, hopefully, maybe, and for many firms, 5 years or never, you'll view me as your advisor and then understand that I'm actually valuable to you. That's a bottom-up approach. I think it's the top-down approach, as someone once said it to us, where if I come in and have that conversation from the get-go as the advisor and talk about how the goals are the most important thing, not just the health, but the success of the business is the important thing. Then from the top down, we can structure the relationship. And then we can connect the numbers, the financials, the regulatory compliance or tax into that picture. See, we're basically shifting the paradigm on its head.
So if I understand it right, you start with the advisory work. You start with the goals of the client, the kind of life they want to live, the future they see for their business and their family, their legacy. And then bring in the specific accounting packages, accounting services that support that. It may or may not be tax compliance. It may or may not be tax planning. It may or may not be bookkeeping, write-up, or client accounting services. It's unique to what that client needs to reach their dreams. And then the accountant assembles the package of services that supports that.
I think that's absolutely said right. Now, unique to the client experience, but not unique to the practice. And it's a streamlined approach. So this is the streamlined side inside of the firm, but to the client, it feels and will be unique and personalized to their goals and what they need. And then yes, the accounting, the traditional services will follow rather than lead.
Mike, with 25 years of experience in working with accounting firms, what are the one or two issues that keep coming up that persist throughout the decades?
Fee resistance, number one. You know, the fee resistance hasn't went away. It's either nagging on the fees that you're currently paying or the competition around fees that we're all experiencing based, again, on the traditional services. So that hasn't changed. It's only gotten worse. More players in the market, more competition outside of the profession, software, non-accounting professionals, etc. The fee has only been driven down, a lot of downward pressure coming on that side, and I see it to continue to get worse. The other thing is the grind of the accounting profession, deadline after deadline, year end. If it's not that, client needs that we're not aware of, the need a loan here, need help there, cash flow problem, It's the constant, you know, phone ringing, email urgency that we experience that aren't really urgencies and can be actually managed in a much better way. But because of that, we go to the 90-hour work week. We go to not working or not being able to take weekends off or holidays off. So those two things have been a crusher in my mind on the fee side and just on the time side.
So what does the firm of the future need to look like, considering that it has to happen now?
And I love the question. Firm of the future, we've talked about this many times over the years in the profession. I think now is the right way to frame it. The firm of now needs to be an advisory-focused firm or business. It needs to be very focused on, I would say, for success, business owners. Business, small to medium enterprise, makes this nation tick. We know that. They are the ones that need growth, need help, are looking for help constantly. We need to be the firm of now that can focus on those businesses, profitability and growth, not status quo, and not just maintenance. And we need to be agile. We need to be not just owner operators. We need to be entrepreneurial in developing teams that can support the advisory services and utilizing those technologies that go along with it. So big departure from what we know, right? Because we've been in such a traditional industry, owner operator moved to entrepreneur, meaning leading the business, growing the business, focused on small to medium enterprises for advisory, no longer dependent upon tax individual work to be successful. And then agile in the form of developing team members so they can also support and play a bigger role with their clients, not just on the tax or compliance side, right? But making an impact on client results. That's what we see as a firm of now.
We've been missing the boat. What do we need?
You're right. We have been missing the boat. We have a lot at our fingertips, particularly on the software side. And we're utilizing software the way we've always utilized reports, historical information, maintenance. The software that's been provided to us, not just now, but over the last few years, has given us dashboards, reports, to not just look at historical information and how we perform, but start setting tone for the future. So better in forecast, up-to-date information. A lot of the software now is plugging right into those accounting softwares. So not only do we have access to it, but our clients have access to it. So now we have a mechanism to be talking about real time where the business is, how it's performing, and where it should be performing, where we can actually start to provide more of a GPS mentality on navigating the financial terrain. So we've missed the boat by constantly going back to, one, the thud effect, where we drop a report on someone's desk. Look at me, I gave you a 26-page report. Client has no idea what to do with that. We've missed the boat in utilizing those reports or even dashboards as a historical review instead of a point of now to the future. And we haven't been sharing that information with our clients in conversations, in management meetings. So utilizing the technology available to us to really step into an advisor role rather than a maintenance role, and really utilizing that to help improve the business every minute, every day, if not monthly, on a regular basis. So I love that you framed it that way. We have missed the boat, but the good news is the boat's still there. We can jump on and we can start making impacts right away.
What should the tech stack look like at an accounting firm?
Yeah, so I'll speak to the advisory part specifically because I know there's a lot of moving parts and different softwares that people are using right now on the accounting side. But the tech deck, in my opinion, is you need to have a good software, holistic if possible. There are many out there that can provide the budget, that can provide the forecasting mechanism, that can even provide the financial or the financial reporting and the cash flow analysis and cash flow monthly reporting on a regular basis. There are a ton of them now that will do that and provide that in a much simple way. That tech should also include graphics, right? Graphical interfaces. I love a dashboard as well. I think the other part of it is data, the ability to bring in data, industry comparisons, industry statistics. Some of that is out there for free right now. Others are built into software so you can actually compare your existing clients. So we need to know how people are performing in their particular industries at any given time, and help use that as a marker for making goals and progress. The other part I would say is there needs to be a better client management system. CRM is one part of that. The other part of that is managing your advisory clients. What is that relationship? Talking about a centralized location for actions and goals and discussions around that. File sharing. This goes well beyond the traditional portal and more into interacting with our clients on a regular basis. The ability for our clients to access us without being over the phone. Have access to those financial performance reports that we're doing on the advisory side. And I think the other thing is you need what if scenarios in your tech deck. What if scenarios, what clients are bringing this to us all the time? What if I expanded? What if I detracted or downsized? What if we changed the menu? These are the things that we need to have software to convey those thoughts into numbers and better for the client results, results from the dollar and our side, and KPI tracking. If we're not doing KPI tracking, you know, again, we might be missing the simplest things that we could be doing with clients that have a profound effect on monitoring and management and our way to results.